Oh, so thanks very much for that introduction, and thanks very much everybody for being here, and thanks for everybody online for taking the time to be here. I felt a little bit standing behind you there. I felt a bit like, how can I explain it? Donald Trump in the second debate, where he was prowling behind Clinton. And there was this wonderful, I remember seeing it, I think it must have been on Saturday Night Live, where they had the theme from Jaws, as he just sort of seemed to be prowling behind. I was thinking while I was standing there that this is supposed to be about decreasing people's stress, and I was just thinking about how I was increasing your stress by just standing behind, just prowling, and you had no idea what I was doing there. But there was a certain amount of trust involved. So thanks very much for asking me to be here and talk about five good ideas to decrease stress. And I really like this format because I'm supposed to be here to get the ball rolling and get you thinking, and then you do the work at the tables, and then with a bit of luck, at the end of the day, I come back with about 20 good ideas. And any time where you give five and get 20 in return, that seems like a pretty good investment of time. We're in changing times, and changing times can be stressful, but they don't have to be stressful. And I think they asked me to be here because I'm a psychiatrist, but I also run Wellesley Institute, which is a non-profit which tries to improve health and health equity in the greater Toronto area. And we've been changing. I've been there for 2-3 years now, and we've been trying to rebuild Wellesley. And so I've been going through change in a different way and trying to think through how to keep things moving. Now, I just need to track back. One of the reasons why I think that stress is important is because stress is a killer. You all understand stress, yes? Yeah. Everybody understands stress, and it's a very, very basic problem that we have. And one of the things I forgot this morning, I was actually going to bring you a little piece of mammoth tusk, because if you go to the Northwest Territories, they'll sell you something they call mammoth tusk, and you're supposed to believe them. I actually choose to believe that they did actually sell me mammoth tusk, because they have tusk that you can just find in the ground there. And why I was going to bring that is because that's a problem we have with stress. We're actually, our bodies are very, very, very well wired to deal with coming across a woolly mammoth and running away from it. Okay? That's what we do. Our bodies are really good at that. If we come across a mammoth, we have the fight, flight, or fright response. Either we run away, or we fight, or we become lunch. Yeah, that's basically what we have. So fright, we stand still and we get eaten. But that's what we do. And what happens at that time, as you know, your stress response kicks in, adrenaline, noradrenaline kick in. What they do is they get you ready to do that. They change the way your blood sugar runs, so you're not storing anything, it's all pumping around your system. They change the way that your blood circulates to your arms and legs so that you can move quickly, and they change the blood circulation to your brain so that you are pepped up and you are the most you're ready for action, you're ready to think your way out of things. And that's how we're set up. And then, you know, 20 minutes later, when we've either won the battle or where we have become a small meal, we're run away, the adrenaline goes out of your body and you get back to normal. That's what we're set up for. What we're not set up for is existential angst. We're just not set up for it. We're not set up for day-to-day microaggressions. That's not what we do very well. And so we have all of this adrenaline coursing around our body, causing stress, causing high blood pressure, causing actually problems. You can end up with kidney problems, and also causing our immune system not to work so well. So stress slowly kills us, but the psychological effects have effects on our behaviors, how we relate to each other, whether we stay in our relationships, how well we do in our relationships. All of those things are linked to stress. And for this, for the purposes of what we're doing today, how well we do at work. Okay? So stress is a killer, stress is a problem, but stress is actually also good for us. So we have to deal with stress, we have to deal with challenges, but we also have to make sure that they don't not only have effects on our physical, on our sort of physiology, on our psychology, but also about our work performance. So we have to deal with stress. Now, obviously, as people who run organizations, we know that a percentage of the stress is brought in from outside. So it's from stuff at home. And some of the stress is from what happens at work. And usually, up until, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, we'd say, well, the stuff that people bring in from home is nothing to do with us. But as you know, some of the laws have changed, and so sort of when we're talking about harassment and other things like that, they do end up being the purview of what happens in our space. But generally, we have to try and decrease stress. And if you look on any of the HR sites, they'll tell you that good management is stress management. So good management is stress management. And if you do it right, you move forward. But about 25 of Canadians on a recent poll said that one of the major sources of stress for them is the workplace. And so we have to think of what we're going to do about stress in the workplace. When people talk about stress in the workplace, you know, it can come from a number of sources. But just to give you an architecture when you're thinking about stress in the workplace, they usually talk about 6 or 7 big areas. The first big area is how your organization works. So management style is very important. The amount of communication and how communication works in the workplace is important. And also the amount of say workers have in decisions. So organizational structure is important. The work type's important. Obviously, the physical sort of layout, where you work, how you work, what the pace of work is, how much control you have of the work and the type of work, whether it's monotonous or whether it changes all of the time. One of the things that a lot of people don't talk about is role. Role ambiguity is a real problem. Yeah, if you don't know what you're supposed to do, or you have clashing roles, that's important and leads to problems. Role conflict and the level of responsibility can be a source of stress. But one of the biggest stresses is interpersonal relationships. So if people get on with their manager, they feel less stressed at work than if they don't get on their manager. If they get on with their peers, they feel less stressed at work than if they don't. And if they know how to manage people, they feel less stressed than if they don't. But in the back of people's minds, also career development is important, and where they're going and whether there's a possibility to move up the company is important. And the last thing that increasingly people are talking about is the work-home interface, whether the amount of work you do means you can't actually do the things you need to at home, whether you take this home or not. And there are some places in the world where it's considered an offense for your boss to bother you at the weekend or after 5 o'clock at night. Sorry? That sucks. Nice. Oh, that's nice. Sorry. I heard that sucks, and I thought, yeah, no, some people are really attached to their work, and that's great, and work-life balance out of the window. But there are some places, and I've been flirting with it at the Wellesley. When people contact me at the weekend, I tend to write back, why are you contacting me? Because why are people doing that at the weekend? And there are some places where they just switch off the email at 5 o'clock. and they just say, we're not going to do that. But anyway, I'm supposed to give you five ideas. That was just a preamble. I'm supposed to give you five ideas, things that you might want to think of. And the first thing is about yourselves. Does anybody know how to keep themselves, there are five things you do to keep yourself psychologically resilient? Sorry?
Good diet.
Good diet, good diet, that's reasonable, yeah?
Time management,
that's okay, yeah?
Exercise,
that sounds good, yeah?
Prioritization,
okay, all right, yeah?
Limit your expectations.
Limit your expectations, okay, we'll talk about that. Yeah, that's, yeah? Sleep, okay, look after yourself, yeah?
Do things for other people.
Do things for other people, yes. And all of you here probably do. And that sounds just about right. The five things, just to let you know, if you do these five things and balance your life, you will be more resilient. The first one is connect and stay connected. So stay connected to friends, families, and other people. Stay connected, yeah? If you lose connection with other people, you're gonna be in problems. The first one is stay connected. The second one is stay active. And I think somebody said exercise. Stay active, stay connected, stay active. The third is keep learning. Yeah, actually, it's good for you. Yeah, keep learning. It's good for you. The fourth one, as you said, is give back. And everybody forgets that people feel generally better if they're giving back. So if you're connected, you're staying active. If you are giving back, and if you are continuing to learn, you will feel more balanced. And then the last one is something that people find a little bit difficult, but really makes a difference, is mindfulness. Have you come across this idea? This idea that there is beauty in everyday little things, that you can really enjoy everyday little things. If any person in here has not looked out at outside and seen how beautiful it is, then you've been missing a mindfulness moment. Yeah, and if anybody hasn't looked at the art and thought, that's expensive, they have missed a mindfulness moment. It's beautiful, expensive, it's a lovely room. And if you haven't looked at the continuum of people who are working in the non-profits and who are here to try and think about stress, you've missed a mindfulness moment. So those five things, if you can do those five things, you will be less stressed. And just think about if you can help other people do those five things by facilitating those five things in your organization, you actually start producing an architecture on which the people who are employed by you feel less stressed. Okay? So start thinking about those five ideas, those five things, and this is just the resilience. That will make you less stressed and more resilient if you can do those five things. Okay? Yeah? Now, actually, it's all written down. It's all on our website for you. You can just click on and it will be there. And I think they've got some handouts just for that resiliency piece. And that will help you think through, because that was stolen from a mental health organisation called Mind in the UK. How many of you know about the stress? Oh, and just while I've got a chance, I can plug. I found that I was out of balance and not doing enough in the way of this mindfulness. And so I decided to do one thing each day. And each day I tweet on a hashtag, which is one of the things I love about Toronto.
One of the reasons.
One of the reasons I love Toronto. Yes, Julia. It's, one of the reasons I love Toronto. I can't even remember my own hashtag. That's how stressed I've got. Thank you very much. And the reason why I started doing that was a really simple thing. If you actually have to think each day about one of the reasons you love being in what is a pretty cool place, quite honestly, it changes how you see the world around you. you actually start looking for positive stuff as opposed to looking for negative stuff. And it's 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, just thinking, sort of, you know, yeah, this is something, you know, what, why do I love being here? And if you can do that, it significantly changes what you do. So it's just being mindful. Okay. So how many of you know about the idea two, which is the stress performance curve? Okay, you've all gone quiet now. When you were asking whether you're in social services or whatever, the arms were going up, people were really excited. Have you come across the stress performance curve? Yeah? No. You all know it, but people don't use it. So the stress performance curve is classic. As your stress goes up, your performance goes up. And then it plateaus. And then if you increase your stress, your performance goes like that. Okay? So, and everybody sees it. I had a terrible experience of watching the stress performance curve in the seventh game of a Stanley Cup, a second round, where the Toronto Maple Leafs were playing the Boston Bruins. And I happened to be in Ottawa, where somehow everybody was a Boston Bruins fan because they hate Toronto. And I was sitting in a bar watching this, and there were about 5-10 minutes to go, and Toronto were 4-1 up. Yeah? 4-1 up with just 10 minutes to go. They've won the game, surely. Yeah? Yeah. And they managed to lose the game. And you could see it coming. And you could see it coming because as the stress had increased, their performance had increased, and they'd got to the pinnacle of their performance, and they were cruising, and they were 4-1. And that's the best they would ever be. And what they needed to do then, somebody needed to get injured, somebody needed to fall down, they needed to just do something to decrease the stress and move themselves back into a good way of playing. That's not what happened. They thought they needed a last push for the last 10 minutes. They increased their stress, their performance went bang, the only time in the whole season where they'd let 3 goals in a 10-minute period because they were all over the place. And that is classic stress performance curve. Why you have to think about it and how you have to think about how that works in a company is in companies, we tend to think that more is more. And sometimes less is more. Sometimes when people are stressed and they've got to the top of their performance, you actually need to do less. You need to work out how they can do less. You have to work out how their jobs can be less stressful rather than giving them more and more and more to do. And, you know, it's really important. It decreases stress. And all you have to do is be mindful of it. It's different for different jobs, obviously. It's different for different people, obviously. But you have to be mindful of it. That sometimes, they used to say, if you want something done, give it to a busy person. Have you ever heard that? Yeah? Stupid. Yeah? If you want something done, give it to the appropriate person. If you keep on giving it to the busy person, your best person is going to crack. That is what's going to happen, yeah? It's a bit like, there are loads of these silly phrases. It's a bit like the phrase, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. You ever heard that? Yeah. If it ain't broke, it's going to break. Okay? That's what's going to happen. I mean, how many of you have a house? Yeah? Okay. Don't fix it. Just wait. It will be fine. Yeah? It won't be a big bill when the hole goes in the roof. Don't worry about that. Don't bother fixing it. Don't worry about maintenance. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. Silly. Similarly, you have to think about your best players, yeah, not just lumping more and more onto them because the stress anxiety curve will eventually break them. They may have more tolerance than the others, but it will break them. You have to think about it. The third big idea is about the idea of coherence. Have you heard about this idea of coherence? Yeah? So classically, when we're in changing times, when we're trying to move things forward, we do a few things. We usually say, okay, we might change our strategic plan. We might change what we're doing, and we're going to move forward. And then some of us will start talking to the staff, and we'll say to the staff, you know, well, this is the way to go, isn't it? This is a great way to go. And the staff will say, yeah, it's a great way to go. It was going to cause a few difficulties in your work, but it's the right way to go. And they say, yeah, it's the right way to go. And then we go off into the distance. And then it goes wrong. And it goes wrong because the staff are stressed. Because it's not a matter of just whether it's the right thing to do. It's whether it is coherent. And coherence is made up of three things. First thing, it's got to make sense. So for an employee not to feel stressed by your change, it just sort of like has to make sense, and it has to be doable, and the rules need to make sense to them. So they need to think that. The second, they have to feel that they can manage the change. And that means that they've got the skills, they've got the support, they've got the training, they can actually do this. So they think they have to feel they can actually do it. And we usually get there pretty quickly. What we don't usually do is ask people, is this worth it? Okay? Because all of that energy, all of that stress takes a toll on an individual. And an individual will only do it if they believe it's worth it. If it's worth it to them, if they're going to get more satisfaction, if it's actually going to make sense to them, if it's coherent, not only you guys want to do it and it seems to make sense, not only I've got the right tools to do this, but also, actually, I want to spend my time, my energy, my life, my stress doing this. It's got to make sense to me. And we usually ask people if our strategic directions are a good idea. We almost never ask people, do you actually really want to do this? Does that make sense to you? And are you really with me? Or are you just saying what you have to? Yeah, because you guys have spent so long thinking it through. Yeah? And it's part, this coherence thing is actually part of the implementation diamond. Do people still talk about the implementation diamond? That usually when you're trying to change things, you sort of think about, right, is it desirable? Yeah? Can I do it? Yeah? So that's where we usually go. Most people in nonprofit solution focused, we want to do this. Yeah? That's how we're going to do it. So it's usually sort of aim-driven. And then we say, how do we do it? And that's the feasibility part of the diamond. Yeah? So what's the strategy for doing it? And that's usually where we stop. But the thing that actually usually undermines most groups in a time of change is not the feasibility, it's the viability. Not can we do it, but can we keep doing it? Yeah. Can we actually maintain that? So you've got your desirability, your outcome, your feasibility, and then the last thing is your viability. And viability is partially built on coherence. Because it's not whether you can get people up to do it, it's whether they'll continue to do it. And if they don't feel it's worthwhile, and if you haven't won the coherence discussion, if you haven't had the coherence discussion, people will just wear out, they'll get stressed, and they'll stop doing it. And that happens all of the time. Fourth way. See, not only am I not able to remember my own hashtag, I can't count from 1 to 5 at the moment. See, and this is what happens. I'm clearly somewhere up there on performance. Yeah, I've peaked. I shouldn't have had the Coke. How many of you in here really give the people who work for you power? Yeah? But keep the hands up. Keep your hands up. You give them power. Yeah? How many of you here do 180 degree appraisal, so your workforce appraise your performance. Kinda. So we give them power, but we don't actually give them power. Yeah, we give people say, but we don't actually give people say. We say to people, you're really part of this, but then we make decisions for people, and we make decisions about how people work. How many of you have flexi time, so people can come and go when they please? Very few, okay. How many people actually let people write their own job plans? Yep. How many people have participatory budgeting, so you actually just take a part? You have?
I have.
Fabulous. Yeah, where you take a part of your money, a part of your, and you just give it to the employees and you say, go play and move us in the right direction. Yeah. There are loads of things that people can do to give people say over their job, say over how they work, say over how you work as the leaders of your organizations, but we don't do them as much as we could. And what you find is if people are given more power, they tend not to abuse it, unless you haven't been nice to them, then, no, they tend not to abuse it at all. And not only do they tend not to abuse it, everything works better. Everything works better. We had a little experiment, or we did a little experiment at Wellesley, where I said, okay, we're going to take a percentage of the budget, and you guys, you just have to work out what projects you're going to do, but they just have to be in line with the Wellesley strategic plan. But you guys just work it out. And they said, well, how are we going to work out who gets the money? And I said, that's up to you. You know, you just work it out. And they said, okay, but who makes a decision in the end whether the project is going forward or not? And I said, well, I can do that if you want, but I'd prefer it to be up to you. So what they did in the end, rather than doing what a lot of people would do, which is produce a first-past-the-post sort of scheme where sort of one person gets the money and other people don't, is they set up a scheme where everybody got money. And everything was shared, and if somebody had a weak proposal, somebody who was strong at writing proposal worked with them. And, you know, they shared everything. And that's how they decided to do it, to make sure there weren't winners and losers and everybody benefited. And we benefited because everybody was happy and less stressed when they came to work, partly because a percentage of their week was theirs. They'd, from start to finish, they had decided how that part of their week and they was run, and they had control over it. So they had say in things. And where there has been participatory budgeting around the world, and governments have done it for various reasons, generally you get better ideas, generally you get more collaborative work, and generally everybody's happier. And you can think of collaborative ways. There are loads of ways of giving people control over their jobs and control over some meaningful decisions in the organization that decrease their stress. Because control decreases the stress. One of the, I've got 2 minutes before I need to stop. Has anybody come across the Whitehall study? No. From somebody a long time ago, from the 70s and 80s, Michael Marmot, who's now a superstar policy person and researcher who goes around the world talking about income inequality, he made his name in the Whitehall study. And at the Whitehall study, what they did is they looked at thousands of British civil servants, and they wanted to look at their health, and they wanted to see the factors that change their health. And one of the reasons why they wanted to look at civil servants was because they all had pensions, they all had health coverage, they all had stable jobs, most of them were unionized, and so all of the poverty factors that are drivers of inequalities in health went out of the window. And what they found, as you might expect, is the person who was at the door, or the doorman or the doorwoman, was more likely to have health and mental health problems than the top civil servants. And there was a gradient throughout the civil service. But then when they got rid of income differences and all of the other things, they still found a gradient so that people at the bottom were twice as likely to have cardiac problems as the people at the top. And they started looking at factors that were most predictive of whether people had cardiac problems and other health problems. And one of the biggest predictive factors was the amount of autonomy the person had over their job. So job autonomy was leading to 100% difference in cardiac problems across a group that were pretty well paid. Everybody was pretty well paid and on a decent wage. And that's the impact that autonomy can have on stress and then on health. Think of the difference of increasing autonomy can have on stress at work and therefore performance of your organization. Now, you're going to come up with a whole bunch of ideas. And my fifth idea is something that you can just look up on a website and it's worth looking at. And there is a standard for a psychologically safe workplace. Have you come across it? A national standard set by consensus, a Canadian standard set by the Mental Health Commission and others. And my fifth idea is read it and think about assessing your organization, think about taking the training, and think about setting up a psychologically safe workplace, because evidence shows that psychologically safe workplaces are more productive, you do better, and you're more resilient to problems. And so rather than me going through it in detail, I'd like to just say that it's there. People have thought it through. They'll come and train you at a price. They will, their self-assessment forms, which are free, and their strategies, which are free, for producing a psychologically safe workplace. So those are the five things that I was going to talk about. The first thing is about resilience and the five ways of producing resilience individually and then also in your organizations. The second was think about that stress performance curve and think about the fact that you can manipulate that. You can do something about that. You can think about that and you can save people unneeded stress. The third thing was coherence. The fourth thing was about giving voice, people having a voice and autonomy and some say over their work. And then the last thing is have a look at those psychological standards from the Mental Health Commission and think about whether you can take that up in your organization. So I've got some questions for you to be thinking about at your tables. Three questions to discuss for the next 20 minutes. And do people online get to discuss as well?
They do, they have an online conversation.
Okay, so they have an online conversation. Three questions. How have you helped your staff manage stress? Are they on your table?
Yes, they are.
They're on the tables. Second, what resources or expertise can you share with others? And I'm really interested in the conversation about that. And then the last one, how would you take the discussion we've had here today back to your organizations and find ways to make some changes? And so it would be lovely, without putting you under too much stress, if at the end of the day, at the end of this afternoon, you come up with things, you can sign up to things that you're going to do to deal with, in my mind, one of the biggest problems that we have in society at the moment, which is, though we're living in abundance, we have so much stress that it is literally killing us. Thank you very much.